Good morning. Let's continue with the chapter 11, that is biotechnology principles and processes. Today we are starting with the topic cloning vectors. We know that plasmids and bacteriophages, they have the ability to replicate within bacterial cells independent of the control of the chromosomal DNA. Bacteriophages, because of their high number per cell, they have very high copy numbers of their genome within the bacterial cells. Some plasmids may have only one or two copies per cells, whereas others may have 15 to 100 copies per cells. Now their number can go even higher. If we are able to link an alien piece of DNA with bacteriophage or plasmid DNA, we can multiply its numbers equally to the copy number of the plasmid or bacteriophage. So vectors, which are used at present, they are engineered in such a way that they help easily linking of foreign DNA and selection of recombinants from the non-recombinants. So let's discuss the features which are required to facilitate the cloning into a vector. Now the first thing that is required is the ORI, or origin of replication. Now this is a sequence from where replication starts in any piece of DNA. Now here you can see in the diagram also, ORI, or origin of replication. This is the sequence from where replication starts, and any piece of DNA when linked to this sequence can be made to replicate within the host cell. This sequence is also responsible for controlling the copy number of the linked DNA. So if one wants to recover many copies of the target DNA, it should be cloned in a vector whose origin support high copy number. Okay, so that is the importance of ORI site. Second is selectable marker. Selectable marker, in addition to this ORI, the vector requires a selectable marker, which helps in identifying and eliminating non-transformants and selectively permitting the growth of transformants. So transformation is a procedure through which a piece of DNA is introduced into a host bacterium. We'll study the process in the next section. Now normally the genes encoding resistance to antibiotics such as ampicillin, chloramphenicol, tetracycline. Tetracycline or kanamycin, etc. Various antibiotics are there. They are considered useful in selectable markers for E. coli. So the normal E. coli cells do not carry resistance against any of these antibiotics. Third is cloning sites. Now in order to link the alien DNA, the vector needs to have very few, preferably single recognition sites. Now recognition sites for the commonly used are the restriction enzymes, and presence of more than one recognition sites within the vector will generate several fragments which will complicate the gene cloning. So the ligation of the alien DNA is carried out at a restriction site present in one of the two antibiotic resistant genes. For example, you can ligate a foreign DNA at this BAMHI site of tetracycline resistant gene in the vector PBR322, and the recombinant plasmids will lose tetracycline resistant due to insertion of foreign DNA, but can still be selected out from the recombinant clones by plating the transformants on ampicillin containing medium. So the transformants which are growing on ampicillin containing medium are then transferred on a medium containing tetracycline, and the recombinants will grow in ampicillin containing medium but not on that containing tetracycline. but non-recombinants will grow on the medium containing both the antibiotics. So in this case, one antibiotic resistant gene help in selecting the transformant, whereas the other antibiotic resistant gene gets inactivated due to insertion of alien DNA and helps in selection of recombinants. So selection of recombinants due to inactivation of antibiotic is a complex process because it requires simultaneous plating of two plates having different antibiotics. Therefore, alternative selectable markers have been developed which differentiate recombinants from non-recombinants on the basis of their ability to produce color in the presence of chromogenic substrate. So in this, a recombinant DNA is inserted within the coding sequence of an enzyme beta galactosidase. So this results into inactivation of the enzyme, which is referred to as insertional inactivation. So the presence of a chromogenic substrate gives blue colored colonies if the plasmid in the bacteria does not have an insert, and presence of insert results into insertional inactivation of the beta galactosidase, and the colonies do not produce any color, and these are identified as recombinant colonies. Now the last is the vectors for cloning genes in plants and animals. Now there are various lessons of transferring genes into plants and animals from bacteria and viruses which have been known this for ages. Now how to deliver genes to transform eukaryotic cells and force them to do what the bacteria or virus want. For example, Agrobacterium tumefaciens, it's a pathogen of several dicot plants, is able to deliver a piece of DNA known as tDNA or transform normal plant cells into a tumor and direct these tumor cells to produce the chemicals required by the pathogen. Similarly, retroviruses in animals, they have the ability to transform normal cells into cancerous cells. So a better understanding of this is delivering genes by pathogens in their eukaryotic host has generated knowledge to transform these tools of pathogens into useful vectors for delivering genes of interest in humans. So the tumor-inducing plasmid of Agrobacterium tumefaciens have now been modified into the cloning vector, which is more pathogenic to the plants and is still able to use the mechanism to deliver genes of our interest into a variety of plants. So therefore, retroviruses have also been disarmed and now used to deliver desirable genes into the animal cells. So once a gene or a DNA fragment has been ligated into the suitable vector, it is transferred into a bacterial plant or animal host where it multiplies. Competent host for transformation with recombinant DNA. Now DNA is a hydrophilic molecule, it cannot pass through cell membranes. Why? In order to force bacteria to take up the plasmid, the bacterial cells must first be made competent. So bacterial cells need to be competent to take up the DNA. So this is done by treating them with a specific concentration of divalent cations such as calcium, which increases the efficiency with which DNA enters the bacterium through pores in its cell wall. Recombinant DNA can then be forced into such cells by incubating the cells with recombinant DNA on ice, followed by placing them briefly at 42 degrees Celsius, which is called a heat shock, and then putting them back on ice. So this enables the bacteria to take up the recombinant DNA. Now this is not the only way to introduce the alien DNA into the host cells. In a method known as micro-injection, recombinant DNA is directly injected into the nucleus of an animal cell. So in another method suitable for plant cells, they are bombarded with high velocity microparticles of gold or tungsten, which are coated with DNA in a method known as ballistic or genes guns. And last method used disarmed pathogen vectors, which were allowed to infect the cells, which are transferred from recombinant DNA into the host cells. Now here you can see the picture of micro injection. The needles with foreign DNA, they are introduced into the cell. So the cell is made competent to get the recombinant DNA, only then the further action will be done. So holding it with the pipette, and this is the host cell where the micro injection is introduced. Now this device injects cells with genetic information using a very heavy metal element, which is bullet coated with plasmid DNA. These are also called as ballistics or gene guns. Now we have learned about the tools for constructing recombinant DNA. We will discuss the processes which are facilitating recombinant DNA technology in the further sections. Thank you for today.